Thank you for having me back again today. I'm going to talk about thermodynamics, information, and consciousness in a quantum multiverse, building on the stuff I talked about yesterday and building very much also on what we heard about from Simon Saunders and how I think the Everett-Rett interpretation combined with some other very basic ideas leads you to some very interesting conclusions. But first, I have to tell you that last night, Joe Silk very kindly hosted us for a very nice dinner and pointed out that a quantum experiment actually has to be repeatable. It's one of the key principles that Simon Saunders mentioned of a good measurement. So let's repeat the measurement we did from yesterday and see if we actually get the same answer. Which view of quantum mechanics is closest to your own? Is it Copenhagen interpretation? If so, raise your hand. We have one. Only one today. Two. You have to raise your hands pretty high so I can see them. Two. Going once, going twice. Two. You're taking notes, Matt? Modify dynamics. Zero. Many worlds. One, two, three, four. Keep them up high, don't be shy. Five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. This experiment is not quite repeatable, I think. I'm going to actually put down here so you can all see. So we got 19 here. We had zero modified dynamics and two Copenhagen. And what about consistent histories? How are they doing today? We have one consistent historian in the corner, going once, going twice. One, and Bohm, how many Bohmians today? One, two, three, and four Bohmians. And how many relational? This is a little bit unfair because you still haven't had, Carl Russell hasn't had a chance to give his talks. Are you holding up your hand or are you thinking about it? I think we need to collapse the wave function. Zero or one. This isn't Florida where you can vote unspecified number of times. Do you want to vote? Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay, three relational. Up by 50. And modal?
Wait till tonight,
yes. None of the above. It's a very strong showing yesterday. One, two. We have three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. Are you just scratching your head, John? Yes. Did I say 22? Okay, now we can test Joe Silk's conjecture here about the repeatability of quantum measurements, because yesterday, this was the state of the wave function here. And so we see, it seems to have been a good day for many worlds overnight. A lot of you slept on it, up from 15 to 19. And Bohm has one defector, but it's been a good night for relational, which went up by 50% here. And this is my last talk, but maybe you can check out after your talk if the numbers have changed again. It's good to see. That means there are a lot of that you are all open-minded and constantly updating your credences, just like Simon says that rational agents should. All right, onwards and upwards. So what I want to talk about today is both the big puzzle of what to make of quantum mechanics and also connect with some other very pesky questions. There's another debate which has raged on in the physics community for about a century also, namely what to make exactly of the second law of thermodynamics. It's proven to be almost as controversial and certainly as long-lived. And on one hand, you have people like Arthur Eddington, who said here very eloquently that the law that entropy always increases holds, I think, the supreme position among the laws of nature. If someone points out to you that your pet theory of the universe is in disagreement with Maxwell's equations, then so much the worse for Maxwell's equations. If it is found to be contradicted by observation, well, these experimentalists, you know, do bungle things sometimes. But if your theory is found to be against the second law of thermodynamics, I can give you no hope. There can be nothing in for it but to collapse in deepest humiliation. thus spake Arthur Eddington. On the other hand, there have been very serious objections raised by other titans like Maxwell, Gibbs, Loschmidt, Poincaré, and more recently, both Roger Penrose, in fact, at the last workshop I attended in Oxford, and also Sean Carroll, have raised some serious issues to do with cosmology and the so-called cosmological entropy problem. And what I'm going to try to convince you of today is that I think that these two great controversies in quantum mechanics and thermodynamics are actually linked, and that actually both of them can be solved at the same time if we simply use the standard entropy definition in quantum mechanics for Neumann entropy, and we reject the idea that the wave function is collapsing, just following the advice here of Simon Saunders. And finally, if we consider all parts of reality, not just the piece we're looking at and the environment, but also ourselves, our consciousness, as part of the physical reality, which I think was also in the spirit of what Simon said, and you attributed this, you called it whose principle? The idea that we should build in even observation and such into the Galileo's principle, yeah. So in other words, what I'm saying is that several of these pesky problems actually have the same solution, and that's the basic theme of the talk today. And the key part of the solution I'm proposing, which tends to be overlooked a lot, is the subject. Okay, so the basic idea here, which we're going to keep coming back to, is we have this big universe made of a lot of particles, or degrees of freedom, if you want to be more abstract. And in the beginning, in the birth of quantum mechanics, people tended to focus only on the object, the hydrogen atom of interest, or whatnot. Eventually, it became clear that actually we really need to pay attention also to the environment. This is what gave rise to the whole idea of decoherence. And Feynman famously wrote that it's convenient to divide our universe into two parts, the thing we're interested in, the object, and the environment, the rest. What I'm saying is actually, don't forget this part too. And what I'm going to be saying is that when you put all three of these things together, you get a very nice, consistent explanation of all these annoying and pesky things. I mentioned yesterday, just for truth in advertising, my own views on this. I don't believe that there's any sort of secret sauce to do involved in consciousness. I think I am my particles, and I think it's the fact that we often have such a hard time imagining that something as prosaic as a bunch of quarks and electrons can give rise to something as amazing as your minds. I think that's just lack of imagination, actually, on our parts. Maya and I were discussing the other day as we were looking out the window at this rabbit. It was a very, very cute baby rabbit. And Maya pointed out that, you know, it's actually just made of clover and grass, rearranged in a different way. And if you'd never seen a rabbit, it would be pretty remarkable. You would have to have a very vivid imagination to imagine that you can just take this green stuff and rearrange it into something so amazing, right? So I think it's actually kind of a little bit arrogant of us to say that, you know, our minds are so amazing that they can't possibly be due to some super complicated interaction of atoms. So this is my starting point. We are atoms, and that means that even if we don't understand exactly how consciousness works, we can still apply quantum mechanics even to our brains. And you can take the entire Schrodinger equation and you can decompose it. You can not only decompose the stuff in our universe into three parts, but you can also take the Schrodinger equation itself and the Hamiltonian, and you can split it into different pieces. Internal dynamics of the object, internal dynamics of the environment, internal dynamics of our mind, and then interactions between the three different pieces. And whenever the object interacts with its environment, that's decoherence. Whenever the object interacts with us, that's observation. And as I mentioned briefly yesterday, our brains also, our neurons certainly interact all the time with an internal environment, which causes decoherence in there, even if we've tried very hard to prevent things outside from decohering. So the information flow within these parts and the information flow between them is crucial. Fundamentally, my guess is that consciousness is basically the way information feels when being processed in certain complicated ways here. And then observation is information being transferred into the system, you know, from what we're looking at. And decoherence is when information is transferred from the system into other stuff. So that's just the basic roadmap of where we're heading. Now, what are these problems that people are fussing so much about? Well, we've spoken extensively here at this meeting about the quantum interpretation problems, so I'm not going to dwell more about formulating those problems. But let me say a little bit about the thermodynamics problems. What's the fuss about entropy? Well, how did things all begin? Great old question. Well, we've made a lot of progress there. We still don't know how it really began, or if there even was exactly a beginning, but we have a very good idea of what happened during the 13.8 billion years since then, because of all the breakthroughs in cosmology which have happened. And we can see much of this now with our telescopes, and we can infer much of what happened during the first 400,000 years also from the Planck data and fossil evidence left over from Big Bang nucleosynthesis and so on. Now, what's the problem with this? Well, we find that we live in a universe where there seems to be a direction of time, right? I remember once I was working when I was 17, selling eggs on the market square in Stockholm where I lived, and I once dropped 25 eggs. It was one of the more humiliating memories of my childhood. As I sat there, and the egg was just flowing down the sidewalk. I looked up, and the crowd had formed around me, and an old lady said, "Oh, imagine how many chickens that could have been." And then the whole crowd started roaring with laughter, and I thought, damn, why is it so hard to sink through the sidewalk? And what does that have to do with this? Well, the eggs fell down, they broke, you know, but we don't ever experience them just sort of unfalling and unbreaking again. This is a very old observation, and yet when we look at the micro world, you could actually play the movie backward of all of these molecules bouncing around against each other, and it would look perfectly reasonable. So why is it that macroscopic time seems to have an arrow, and macroscopic doesn't? Well, people have argued about it for 100 years. There's one very deep insight, which everybody now agrees on, which is sort of shocking, which is that the asymmetry that we see in a dropped egg in the kitchen or in Stockholm actually has its ultimate explanation in the origin of our universe. Huh? What does an egg have to do with the universe? Well, the basic answer, and this dates back to early thinking even by Boltzmann and others, is of course that the reason that things are gradually getting messier and messier, and so-called entropy is rising, is because entropy was lower yesterday, was in an unusually low state yesterday, and it tends to get higher. Why was it the entropy so low yesterday? Well, because it was even lower the day before yesterday. Oops, and why was that? Well, because it was even lower 1 billion years ago, and even lower at the very early stages of our universe. So you've sort of kicked the bucket back. It's kind of always pushing it back to something else. It's kind of like the way we try to deal with the Euro crisis. And then some people say, okay, let the cosmologist worry about that. But then there are cosmologists like Sean Carroll and others, Roger Penrose has pointed out that, well, maybe even inflation, which was supposed to create this special low entropy state, actually doesn't really solve that problem satisfactorily either. And hence the debate rages on, okay? So that's the statement of this problem. Why is our entropy so low? Our entropy could be 10 to the 120 bits or so in our universe. It's actually about 10 to the 89. It's way lower than it could be. We're not anywhere near heat death here. We're living on a 300 Kelvin planet, irradiated by a 6,000 Kelvin sun, cooling off into a 3 Kelvin space. That's why we can have the conference, right? How do we understand that ultimately? So let's take a step back and just to make sure we have remind ourselves of the key tools. What is entropy? In classical physics, entropy is just a measure of our ignorance, as formalized by Shannon, who just said if you have something you're ignorant of, like whether this upside down playing card is this one or one of 8 different possibilities that you're indifferent between. So we'd say there's a probability of 1/8 for each. The entropy is 3 bits. It's given by that little formula. So you need 3 bits of information to specify a number between 0 and 7. If you now happen to find out that actually it's a queen, then the entropy goes down to 2 bits. You have less ignorance. If you now find out that it's a black card, you've got one, you learned one more bit of information about the system, entropy is only 1 bit. Say 0, 1, whatever. And if you know, if you turn the card over, no more ignorance, entropy is 0 bits. Okay, that's the Old Testament, that's classical mechanics. How do you do entropy in quantum mechanics? Well, John von Neumann provided a very elegant generalization of this to quantum mechanics, which is completely standard. In quantum mechanics, we don't have probability distributions, of course. The state of everything might be given by a wave function, as Simon Saunders said. But as already Erwin Schrödinger pointed out in an early paper, a subsystem of something doesn't have a wave function because it's entangled with the rest. But you can always describe all there is to know about any subsystem by a slightly more general thing called a density matrix. So instead of a vector of complex numbers, it's a table of complex numbers, or a matrix, as we say in math jargon. The simplest case would be a 2x2 matrix, a 2x2 table of numbers, where if it's like this, with say 1/2, 1/2 on the diagonal of the matrix here and 0 elsewhere, we can interpret this as that, oh, it's either this way or that way. Say this pen is either here or there. Whereas if you have these numbers off the diagonal, that means it's not classical uncertainty. It's actually there and there at the same time in quantum superposition. So these numbers off to the side here, if you can get rid of them somehow, you turn the and into or, and you make the classical thing, the quantum thing, seem more like a classical thing. And decoherence, as we'll come back to, does exactly that for you. Von Neumann's definition of the entropy says you take this matrix and you take the log of the matrix multiplied by itself and minus the trace. And what that means in plain English is you diagonalize the matrix and then you treat the things on the diagonal as probabilities and use Shannon's formula on that, okay? So to summarize, quantum mechanics, you just replace the probability distribution of classical physics with a density matrix. You replace Shannon entropy with von Neumann's formula, and you're good to go, okay? Now, so is there really an entropy problem? And why is our entropy so low? Well, philosophers are very annoying to us physicists. I think that's awesome, because they are annoying by catching us whenever we use sloppy language and saying we need to really be rigorous. A lot of people who complain about the entropy problem, they make a terrible mistake and talk about the entropy without saying what entropy they mean. Okay, and as I'm going to explain to you shortly, that's a cardinal sin, because there is no such thing as the entropy, as I'm going to come back to. I'm going to try to persuade you shortly here that you actually each have your own personal density matrix, which describes everything there is that you in particular know about our world, and it's different, a little bit different for each one of us. And that's not in any way a denial that there also is an external physical reality. We still have a wave function of everything, it's out there. But it's very convenient that you don't need to know it to calculate everything you ever can calculate, and I'll come back to this. Now, a brief summary of where I'm going with this is my explanation of why the entropy is so low is it has two parts to it. First of all, I'm going to argue that basically the entropy of something, it decreases when you look at it, and you get information about it, you learn about it, and it increases when you don't look at it, when it undergoes decoherence, or if you put some stuff in a certain place, if I do, and then my son Alexander messes with it when I'm not looking at it, you know, that now I know less about it, and I suddenly can't find it, or whatever. And that's the first part, but that's not enough, as it's going to turn out, to explain why our universe has so low entropy. So to lower entropy a lot, I'm going to show you a result that I got in a recent paper, which I'm very excited about, but when you connect this with inflation, you can get fantastic reductions in entropy and actually make a nice low entropy universe like we live in, all right? There's been a lot of nice work on the second law of thermodynamics over the last 100 years. Seth Lloyd, for example, in his PhD thesis in 1988, showed that if you have a completely isolated system where, according to standard quantum mechanics, the density matrix, its entropy never changes at all. If you just have the object doing its thing, you're not observing it, it's not decohering, its entropy always stays the same. Seth showed that if you don't know exactly what's happening to it, you can derive something like the second law. So he is in this camp who would say that the entropy is a measure of our ignorance, but that's also super controversial, okay? For example, David Albert, famous philosopher of science, who many of you know, said at a meeting that I co-organized 2 years ago that thinking that entropy has anything to do with what we know about a system is a bad, misleading mistake. Yeah, that's what he thinks. On the other hand, now I disagree, and this is actually a disagreement that goes back to an argument between Boltzmann and Gibbs about a century ago. I'm interested in using physics to figure out, to make predictions about my future, okay? And in fact, knowing the full quantum state of all of reality is neither necessary for that, nor is it in fact sufficient. Okay? Why is it not sufficient? Well, suppose I want to predict what's going to happen to me tomorrow, okay? If I know the state of the entire universe out there, everything out there, okay? Suppose it's an infinite space and there are several different people in there who look exactly like me and have exactly the same experiences as me. Then with this omniscient view, I don't actually know which one is this one. So I can't figure out what's going to happen tomorrow. I know this particular Max tomorrow is going to get hit by a bus because he forgot that you drive on the left side of the street in London, whatever, and this guy is going to have something better happen to him. So this indexical information about what I am is actually crucial. On the other hand, so I need to know where I am in the three-dimensional space. I also need to know where I am in Hilbert space, because if Simon Saunders is right, and the Everett interpretation is correct, I exist in many different branches of the wave function. Okay, in one I got invited to this meeting, and in another one I didn't. So if I know the full wave function, and I want to know what's going to be the first question after this talk, I need to know what branch I'm in. Okay, that's not something which is, it doesn't say anywhere in the full wave function, because it has both. So I need to know, I need to condition on what I actually know about my location, both in 3D space and in Hilbert space, to get the right density matrix to work with. On the other hand, it also isn't necessary for me to know the state of everything to predict what's going to happen tomorrow. For example, I can safely ignore everything about the Andromeda galaxy for tomorrow, because what's happening there right now is going to take 3 million years to have an influence on Earth, right? All that's relevant is stuff that's nearby, and I can do the operation known as partial tracing to just get rid of all that irrelevant information. That's why, in fact, we can, with our small brains, do so much useful physics, because we don't need all the information about the world to make predictions about it. That's why we can make predictions for things which are much bigger than us, okay? So we all have our personal density matrix, which is related to the full quantum state by doing two separate things. You do conditioning, like in classical Bayes' theorem, folding in the information you already know, and then you also marginalize in classical physics, or partial trace, as we call it in quantum geek speak, over the stuff that you don't need to know. Okay? So the true picture, way to think about our universe in the Everett picture is that really we start out in some weird quantum fuzz, the particles are in a superposition of different places, and then you evolve into a superposition of many different classical universes. We're in this one maybe where the galaxies are organized the way we actually photographed them with a Sloan Digital Sky Survey, but there's another branch where the galaxies are in a different order, where the Big Dipper has a different pattern to it, whatever. And talking about the entropy of the whole thing is completely irrelevant for us. The entropy of the full quantum state could be zero if it's a pure state. What matters is if you know that you're on this particular branch, and you then what? And you partial trace over the things you don't care about, then what's the entropy? That's what we actually measure for when we talk about things. So we should avoid loose talk about the quantum density matrix or the entropy. All right? So what can we do about this then? Having said that, there are some very specific mathematical recipes. There are three cookbook recipes for dealing with all of physics. Cookbook recipe one is what we all learned in kindergarten or grad school or whatever when we first took quantum mechanics. If the object is not is just interacting with itself, then we use unitary evolution, we solve the Schrodinger equation, we figure out what's going to happen. Okay? for example, as we saw yesterday, if you put an object like a card balanced exactly like this, it'll fall down in a superposition of two different places. It's an example of where entropy does not change. Start with being in a definite quantum state. Now you're in a definite quantum state too, albeit the sort of Schrodinger cat-like one. The second interesting case is when the object interacts with the environment, when and causing the environment to learn information about what the object is doing. Okay? And as was famously shown first by Dieter Tse, and then pioneered by a lot of nice work through Wojtek Zurek and many others, what that does is it takes this density matrix and exactly gets rid of these off-diagonal elements, basically changing AND into OR. Now it's here AND there, and now it's here OR there, effectively in two places at once. We can think of things as having branched, as Simon said, even though, of course, there's still just one wave function. Okay? That's what decoherence does. I'm not going to bore you with all the math here, so because you can read about that elsewhere if you want to. But the bottom line is, it's with only one page of math, you can derive this very simple result that these magic off-diagonal numbers, which sort of distinguish between quantum superpositions and just classical ignorance, can be made to go away. A key thing about this is, it doesn't say anything about what kind of system it was that involved in this math that interacted with the object. I, in this calculation, used the symbol smiley face and sad face for the system that was kind of observing the object to sort of make you think that it's a person looking. But the math doesn't care. You can use whatever symbol you want. So this leads to the very, very simple answer to the question of what counts as an observer, actually. You know, do you need to be a human or a mouse or a robot, or does it suffice with a photon? Einstein wondered about whether a mouse looking at the moon would actually, you know, affect it. We now have a very simple answer to this, which is all of the above can count as having these effects. What matters isn't whether you're conscious or not. What matters is just the transfer of information. If you have something which is both here and here at the same time, for decoherence to take place, it'll work just fine if for example, Simon Saunders comes out and up and looks at it and then walks away. But it'll work equally well if just one particle of light comes in and bounces off of it, bounces away, because now where that particle of light is going to be a little bit later will depend on where it was, right? So by looking at where the photon is, you can figure out where the remote control was. The information has leaked out. You can think of, in a way, keeping quantum mechanical things quantum mechanical being all about keeping things secret. As soon as the information about what's going on leaks out anywhere else, whether it be encoded in a human brain or in the position of a photon, you're no longer going to be able to measure any interesting quantum behavior there. All right? Let me just say a couple of other quick things about decoherence also, because I want to just make clear this is not just something very philosophical. It's something very practical. You can calculate all sorts of things with. First of all, decoherence is actually the fastest process in nature by a huge amount. Okay? And just to appreciate that a little bit, suppose I take a cup of coffee from outside and I drop a sugar cube into it. And I think of my sugar cube as system one, the object, and the coffee as the environment. This is going to interact with the coffee as it hits it, right? There are going to be several things happening. There's going to be some dissipation, where some of the energy of the sugar gets dumped into the coffee. It's going to slow down through friction. There'll be some fluctuation also, Brownian motion, if you look really carefully on the sugar from the random motions of the molecules in the coffee. There'll also be communication, whereby information is transferred. So there'll be information in the coffee about exactly where the sugar fell from the waves in the coffee, right? And as a result of the information transfer, there'll be decoherence. And for each of these four kinds of processes, you can write down a time scale. How long time typically does it take for this thing to be important? The dissipation time scale is the time it takes for the about half the energy, say, of the sugar of motion to be lost, right? And that scales roughly like the number of particles. If you have 10 to the 25 particles in the sugar, they each have energy, and you have to have about 10 to the 24, 10 to 25 collisions until with coffee molecules, water molecules, until you've gotten rid of all of the energy. But how long does it take for information transfer to happen? It takes only one collision. The first collision that happens between any of the 10 to 25 sugar molecules and one molecule from the coffee cup already gives away all the whole secret about, oh, it's here. And what that means is that the process of decoherence is about 10 to the 25 times faster than the process of dissipation. It's huge, right? That's why it's a ridiculously fast effect, because dissipation and fluctuation is about the transfer of information. Sorry, a transfer of energy, which is slow. Decoherence is about the transfer of information. You need just one particle hit. If you look at this a little bit graphically and you classify systems by what the ratio is of the dissipation to the decoherence time and the dynamical time of, you know, a motion compared to decoherence, it separates out very nicely. So you see things are going to act quantum if both the decoherence time is very long and also the dissipation time is very long. So they're acting kind of independently and they don't decohere. If they decohere, but there's still dissipation and friction still is slow enough to leave them a lot of autonomy, that's classical systems. But if the dissipation time also is faster than the dynamics time, that's like if you have a little pebble that you've thrown into a jar of honey. Dissipation is so big it doesn't really have much dynamics of its own at all, and it's not an independent system anymore. Okay? Another thing worth stressing about this is you can put numbers to all of this. In fact, the very first paper I wrote in my entire life was just working out a bunch of timescales for these things. You can take, for example, a bowling ball and ask, you know, how often does it bump into something? Well, an electron gets bumped by air molecules here in this room every 10 to the minus 13 seconds. It doesn't get bumped very often at all by a solar neutrino. You can put numbers to all of this stuff. And the bigger the thing is, typically, the more it bumps into the environment. So we realize that the reason that big things tend to look classical isn't because they're big. It's just because big things tend to be harder to isolate from the rest. And we also know that if you take a thing, it's isolated and just leave it alone, its quantum wave function tends to spread out. But every time it bumps into something, these quantum superpositions get destroyed by decoherence. So there'll be sort of an equilibrium coherence length of each kind of thing. And you can see, if you put a bowling ball in this room, its coherence length is 10 to the minus 21 meters, so you can never measure any weird quantum bowling things. I have to make other excuses for bowling so badly, okay? Whereas if you have, for example, even if you take little things like electrons, it's pretty easy to have them spread out over very, very large distances, especially if you pump out the air of your experiment and so on. But for big things, it's really hard. You can never get rid of the solar neutrinos, for example. And even if you do perfect vacuum, super low temperature, a bowling ball is always going to be pretty localized just because it gets hit by solar neutrinos, you know, once in a while. I have to also confess something to you, Joe, which I don't think I confessed before, that this was my first paper ever, but I actually never showed it to you when I was a grad student because I was embarrassed and I thought you were going to disapprove of it. So I checked that you were far from the laser printer before I printed it out, and I didn't show it to you until after you signed my PhD thesis. And that's so ironic, because now I realize that you were all along much more open-minded about these things than I gave you credit for, and you're even inviting me now to speak about this. So this brings closure to this. I'm now fully out of the closet. So let me skip over this little, if you download my very last paper on the archive, we're about to post, it's about how you can explain why space-time looks so classical using decoherence, because neutrinos and things keep flying through space. But I'm going to spare you the details of that. Let's talk now instead about the third interaction, when the subject that we're interested in interacts with us, observation. That was the main topic of yesterday's lecture that I gave. So if I interact with it, then my state, it's not the environment that gets entangled with the thing, it's my mental state that does. If I bet money on that this card is going to fall down face up, then when I look and see that, I get happy. And then the other branch of the wave function, the card is down and I'm unhappy, and because of decoherence, we can think of this, as Simon said, as the universe having split off into two parts. This is a summary table of how all these three kinds of processes are linked to one another, okay? If the object interacts with itself, then this is how the density matrix evolves, just unitarily. Entropy stays the same. When the object interacts with the environment, you get decoherence. This is the most general formula for the most arbitrary weak interaction or strong or whatever you want with the environment. And that increases the entropy. And in a recent paper, I also worked out the most general effect of on the density matrix from observation in the many worlds formalism. And this is what the formula looks like. I can give you the paper afterwards if you want to look into the math. And here, generally, entropy decreases, just like you would expect. And this last formula here actually is exactly the quantum mechanics version of Bayes' theorem, for those of you who are familiar with this. Bayes' theorem says that if you don't know for sure what's going on, but you have a probability distribution reflecting your credence in different possibilities, then when you get more evidence, you make some kind of observation, it gives you a rule for how you should update your probability distribution to factor that in. What this formula does is exactly the same thing. You have your personal density matrix, which summarizes all your knowledge about the rest of the world. And then when you learn something by interacting with the world or the object, this formula shows you how to update your personal density matrix. And this lets us come back to this third rail now and talk about the second law of thermodynamics, which is so controversial, and say a couple of more nuanced things about it. It's simply not true that if you define entropy as the von Neumann entropy, that entropy always increases. Obviously, that cannot be the case. So if you're going to have some explanation for why it's so low now. Crudely speaking, increases when you don't look at the world, and it decreases when you make observations. So we can say that there's a second law of thermodynamics, part one, which says that the entropy of the object cannot decrease unless it interacts with me, unless I observe. So the standard second law of thermodynamics is perfectly true, in other words, as long as I don't make an observation. And sure enough, already when they first formulated the second law, Maxwell's demon came along, right? And which shows a kind of violation, which is exactly linked to this loophole, that if you're making observations, if the Maxwell demon can see what the atoms are doing, it can lower entropy. And then we get the converse of this, saying that the object, the entropy of the object, it cannot increase unless it interacts with the environment. The only way you can actually increase entropy is through decoherence. Okay? Now, so far, this is just a bunch of fancy words, but can I actually prove this? Should you actually believe it? Well, what does it mean to prove it? If you go back to the math, for the most general, does decoherence actually always increase entropy? Well, mathematically, if you skip all the mumbo-jumbo math and the derivation, it boils down to saying you have this density matrix, and the most general kind of interaction that you can have with the environment corresponds to taking this table of numbers and doing this with it. This weird circle I learned is called the Schur product. And if you take the Schur product of two matrices, two tables of numbers, you don't multiply them like you normally multiply matrices. You just slap one on top of the other and multiply all the numbers that lie on top of each other. That's called the Schur product, okay? So in other words, after the decoherence, the new density matrix is just equal to the product of the old density matrix, and each component gets multiplied by some thing here, okay? And this thing is just like is basically a correlation matrix. It's a matrix that has only ones on its diagonal. It has no negative eigenvalues. It's Hermitian, so it's sort of a complex correlation matrix. And it's a very elegant and beautiful math question. Is it true that whenever you take a density matrix and you just do this to it, you sure multiply it by a correlation matrix, that the entropy will always increase? Or can it sometimes decrease? I was astonished after looking very hard to not find any proofs for this in the literature. So in this paper I wrote, I actually was able to get a proof and And it's not super hard. It turns out, if you use a nice 1985 theorem, which is very recent in the math literature, things proven in 95, when about matrices, where most things were proven over 100 years ago, by Bapat and Sundar, you can show that the... Actually, let me skip the math details and just come back to the conceptual things. I can give you a copy of the paper. Suffice it to say, you use actually some very beautiful math. I thought I kind of knew already all there was to know about linear algebra, but now I realize I didn't. There's this fantastic field of majorization and sure multiplication and stuff, which give you some really awesome power tools for proving stuff about quantum stat mech. And using this is simply a theorem, and you can take my word for it today that it's true, and if you don't trust me, I can show you the proof in this paper, okay? So that was the easy half. What about the other part? We would also like to prove that the entropy goes down when you observe something. So can we prove that too? This other half of the second law? Well, Shannon, the father of information theory, already proved for classical physics, the classical version of that. He said that when you look at something, he said it's not true that the entropy always goes down. That's actually false. But it always goes down on average, he said. On average, when you look at something, when you measure something, you'll always learn something about it. So its entropy actually goes down. And what Shannon proved was, in fact, that the entropy will always go down by what's called the mutual information that's been established between you and the thing from you interacting with it. And he also proved that that mutual information is always a positive number or zero if the measurement failed. So in other words, if you get any information at all about something, its entropy will on average go down. So I would like to prove the same thing for quantum mechanics. This turned out to be really hard. I convinced myself that it must be true. I ran huge numbers of numerical simulations where I took random observations and all my 10,000 cases, and it always worked. So I was convinced that this was true, but I couldn't prove it. It kept eluding me. It was significantly harder than the other proof. So then what happened was actually very fun. This undergrad student at MIT, and this is one of the reasons I just feel so lucky to work there, that we have students like this. This awesome Armenian undergrad student, just a super smart kid, he came in and said, I need to do a project for my quantum mechanics course. I had to write a term paper. Do you have a project? So I was like, try this and see if you can prove this theorem. It was very easy to explain. I thought, I'll never see him again. Actually, I wasn't so sure because I had great respect for him. Otherwise, I wouldn't have given this problem to him. He went off and started devouring all these super abstract math books and stuff. And it was really hard. It was kind of like pulling teeth, actually. This is him here, pulling teeth. This is actually a rather eclectic rendition of the play Electra, where pulling teeth was supposed to symbolize the curse that had been placed upon him. But so he also has a sense of humor. But one day, he came into my office and didn't look like that. He looked like this. And then I realized, he just proved it. And he found this absolutely beautiful proof of this theorem. So it is true. And to summarize so far what I've told you is, if you just consider our universe as all of reality as a whole and try to get rid of this dualistic dichotomy about my mind is somehow different from everything else, it's the whole world, it's convenient for me to divide it into my mind, the subject, the thing I'm looking at, the object, and the rest, then I can prove these two things, that whenever I look at something, its entropy will on average learn something about it, its entropy goes down. When I don't look at it, its entropy goes up, okay? So, in my last 3 minutes here, doesn't that solve the entropy problem of a universe and explain why the entropy is so low because we've looked at it? No, it doesn't. Why not? Because what typically happens when you look at something, if you measure 10 bits of information about something, its entropy goes down by 10 bits. Okay? The most information I can store in my brain, I don't know exactly how many terabytes it is, or maybe I'm down to kilobytes now, given how bad my memory has gotten. You know, I certainly can't store the 10 to the 30 bits, whatever is needed to bring. I need to bring the entropy of our universe down from 10 to the 123 or so, down to 10 to the 89, right? So how can it be that the entropy is not just a few bits lower than the maximum, but so low? How can that be? Well, by combining quantum mechanics actually with inflation, which is one of the most powerful ideas that has swept cosmology in the last 30 years. So super briefly, inflation, the key thing that inflation does, which helps here, is it causes very long-range correlations. If you start with a vast space, you might create an enormous swath of space that has inflated, okay, and become in a certain state, whereas everything else might be in the old messy pre-inflationary state, for example. This is very overly simplistically drawn, but that doesn't actually weaken the conclusions. Interestingly, there Seth Lloyd has an alternative mechanism for trying to explain the cosmological stuff through a phase transition instead of inflation. And in a phase transition, you tend to get very much the same thing. You get large correlated patches in a certain phase, very long-range correlations. Regardless of what it is, let's say it's inflation for now. Let's take a toy model here and just say, suppose there's some process which happens where at some point, so half of all of the volume of space has undergone inflation and become, let's call that habitable, and color it green. Whereas if you're not in and those are big contiguous regions of space, much bigger than our observable universe, okay? And then the rest is a mess. So maybe every Planck volume is either habitable or not habitable, or, okay? Our universe is much smaller than these blobs, so either we're in here, or we're in there, those are with overwhelming likelihood. If it turns out in this case, if you just repeat that calculation which gave the depressing result that the entropy only goes down one bit for every bit I measure, you get a completely different answer. Here's the answer you get, okay? If you haven't had any kind of inflation, if you plot the total entropy of our world, versus how many bits I've measured, it just goes down linearly. Measure 50 bits, it goes down by 50 bits. But if inflation has happened, the entropy drops off exponentially rather than linearly, okay? I started with a toy model here with 50 bits, but you can see the formula here. The total entropy goes down exponentially. Basically, it gets cut in half for every observation I make. So if I want to get it down 30 orders of magnitude, I only have to observe 100 bits of information, and I can get this kind of very low entropy universe, okay? So this actually, in my mind, settles it and is very good news and really helps explain why inflation solves these problems for us. And I think ultimately the critique which Roger Penrose and Sean Carroll leveled against inflation for this was very interesting, but it can be solved when you do quantum mechanics properly. And I want to end on that note, skip over these little details here, and just summarize to say that what I've tried to convey with you is that understanding all of nature, if you include all of nature, including both the stuff we're looking at and the stuff we're not looking at and our own mind, that actually provides a much deeper understanding of more than one thing. It provides a deeper understanding of quantum mechanics. It explains what measurement really is, and it explains the emergence of the classical world through decoherence. And it also provides a deeper understanding for thermodynamics. It's just too simplistic to say, entropy always increases, we're doomed to heat death, and I'm not going to bother cleaning up my desk because it's just going to get even messier. To be a little bit more nuanced instead and say entropy can go up and down because the relevant entropy to talk about is the entropy of my own personal density matrix. Entropy will go up when I'm not looking at something and it interacts with the environment, and will go down when I am looking at it. And a unifying theme of all this is information. I said earlier that I think of consciousness as just being information, the way it feels when it's being processed. And it's very interesting that all of these processes that we've spoken about today involve information flow, right? If consciousness is information flowing around inside here of the subject, then observation is information flow between the object and the subject. Decoherence is information flow between the object and environment. And the whole business about entropy and bits is also all about information. So information, I think, has gone from being just some little curiosity that we leave to computer scientists to being something which seems to be very firmly built into the very foundations of physics. And I'm going to end by now destroying all credibility I may have built up here. And I was happy that we got more votes from Many Worlds today than yesterday, but Joe Silk convinced me to commit respectability harakiri by showing a little video last night. And it's this. It's a video that summarizes kind of what I've said, but it's not made by me. It's made by this rock band, which involves Guy Berryman from Coldplay and Magne Furu Holmen and Jonas Bjerre. And without further ado, let's see if you talk to me again after this. What these guys did, I have no idea why, but I had given them an advanced copy of this book that I've written, Our Mathematical Universe, and they, for some crazy reason, decided that it would be a good idea to sing out of the book. And this is what they did.
Everything, even light, seems to be made of particles. Mathematically, the state of these particles cannot be described by six numbers. Their position and velocity, but by a wave function, giving them properties both of particles. They exist or they don't, and they can be in several places at once in a so-called super precision. This equation shows that instant microscopic superpositions can get amplified into crazy macroscopic superpositions. Like you personally deciding to be into places at once. This mathematically simplest quantum theory, where the Schrödinger equation always rules, predicts the existence of parallel universes where you live on countless variations of your life.
Thank you.
Wow.